of the series, perhaps.
Not ever, I hope.
No. We're hoping to do something on Scotland, the Scottish referendum in June. This is the last one on the continental picture with the European elections and the implications for us back in the UK, what the outcome might be. So Simon Fiction with LSE is going to kick off.
First, I've got a little slide, the in the handouts there for you. Why I think the European elections might be more about Europe this time than the previous elections. I'll say a little bit about the outcome of the elections. A bit about the back of the Commission presidency, whether it matters. And I'll talk a bit about policy implications. And some of what I'm going to present is related to my other hat, which is running this NGO in Brussels called VoteWatch, for track what goes on in the Parliament and be involved with project predicting and forecasting the elections. The latest forecast will be posted online tomorrow. Normally, as you know, European elections are not really about Europe, they're normally about national politics. It's the same in every member state. They move to national contests, national governing parties do badly, small parties do well, opposition parties do better than governing parties. Europe is much more salient across the continent this time. In fact, the Press Office and the European Parliament have been collecting data on media coverage of the elections, and they claim that in terms of column issues, it's been covered five times more than 5 years ago. Mentions of the European elections in the national press. They're not really sure why this is. Part of it's just the salience of the topic. For the Eurozone member states, the politics of the Eurozone crisis, in the south and the southern periphery, austerity being imposed from Brussels is one of the key themes in the campaign. In Northern Europe, in the bailout states, it's why should we bail out lazy Greeks and Portuguese? It's an issue in Germany, Netherlands, Finland, Slovakia, several other states. The other issue is anti-EU migration sentiment. And parties on the radical right in several member states, like UKIP, UK, Le Pen, France, Wilders, Holland, the Danish People's Party, Denmark, and now even in AFD, Alternative for Deutschland, Germany have now added anti-EU migration sentiment to their anti-Eurozone platform. And so you're seeing a rise in support for the radical left in southern Europe against bailout, against austerity rather. You're seeing a rise in support for the radical right in northern Europe, northwestern Europe, against bailouts from the south, plus anti-EU migration sentiment. The other little European element, which is a new element, is this back and forth Commission presidency. We have the Spitzenkandidaten, as the German press are calling it, Juncker, Schulz, Verhofstadt, or as the European Conservative and Reformers group call it, Schöjungstadt. Maybe we'll have a little picture of the merge of the three. The candidate Tsipras from Greece, Keller Bove, the Green candidate. Not much coverage in the UK, much more coverage on the continent. There was a live TV debate in France between Juncker and Schulz, a live TV debate in Germany. There was a candidates debate between all of them in Maastricht, the university, that was taken by a lot of the national press. There's going to be a big event next week, live debate in Brussels, with all the candidates, including Tsipras, that will be now taken by a lot of the national press and constant BBC Parliament, and this will be shown in the UK versions that can watch it. But it's interesting how this has now taken on much more significance in several member states than it has here in the UK. It's undermining the British government's view of this process, which we'll come back to. This polls in the UK, and the UK Independence Party top. They might not win more seats than Labour, depends on how it breaks down by the constituency. I can talk about that if you're interested. Generally, the key theme, the key issue in the unique feature of these elections compared to previous elections is this rise in Eurosceptic populist right, who could come top in several member states. UKIP would probably come top in the UK, Danish People's Party top in Denmark, Le Pen could come top in France, Jobbik really radically anti-Europe extreme right, In Hungary, the NVA, Flemish Nationalist Party, could well join ECR, British Conservatives at the top in Flanders. FPO doing well in Austria and so on. Truthin is the third in Finland, and all around the same standard, also the same status in the Netherlands. PDV, coming out of Wilders' party. Owen Dorn, extreme right in Greece. The Alternative for Deutschland, the anti-Europeans in Denmark, I mean in Germany, and the Swedish Democrats, the extreme right in Sweden. Very different. They're all very different parties. They're all somewhere to the right of the EPP, and it probably means there could be well over 100, 120 MEPs to the right of the EPP in various different groups. Here's what the latest forecast from Pollwatch. We post them up every week, every Wednesday. Two more to go before the election. This one is from last Wednesday, and it's based on the latest European election polls in every member state, averaged across the last two or three, depending on the time period. And you can see there the current parliament in the inner hemicycle and what the new parliament might look like in the outer hemicycle. You can see rise in the support on the left, that's the radical left from there. The socialists are significantly bigger, EPP significantly smaller, and the groups or parties or MEPs to the right of the EPP a lot larger. So that is the European ECR. They may get some other allies in the ECR, as I mentioned, the new French alliance. British Conservatives, I understand, also talking to the Danish People's Party and the True Finns about them also joining this. But I think at this stage it's unlikely to join ECR. They probably would stay in Farage's group EFD, particularly if Farage can get Grillo from Italy to join them. Grillo is now making noises that suggest he might sit in the night of Farage. So if Grillo joins Farage, if Alternative for Deutschland joins Farage, if the Danish People's Party truth is staying in France, we could end up with 60 MEPs, which would make the fourth largest group in the European Parliament. There will probably also be a new group out of those 99 over there currently in the we don't know where they'll go category, which is the Le Pen-Wilders alliance. They are standing together as an alliance. They probably are going to get enough MEPs for enough member states. You have to get 25 MEPs for at least 7 member states. They're easily going to get 25. They're probably going to get 40, maybe 50, and it'll be from 7 or 8 member states. So they should have, we could end up with 3 groups to the right of the EPP, all with between 40 and 60 seats, and a rump, really extreme right, Jobbik, Golden Dawn, and some various odd characters from Eastern Europe over there. Right. But as a block, this is really going to be a big, significant block in terms of a voice in the European Parliament. Anti-European Eurosceptic right. The debate about the Commission presidents were interesting because this is actually what the treaty says. I just wanted to show you this because there's been lots of arguments about what it says in the treaty. So the treaty, Lisbon Treaty said the following. Taking into account the actions of the European Parliament, after having held appropriate consultations, the European Council, that's the head of the government, acting by a qualified majority, not unanimity, shall propose to the European Parliament candidate. President of the Commission, the candidate shall be elected by the European Parliament by a majority of its components. If it does not obtain, if he sick, does not obtain the required majority, the European Council acts by a QAB, shall be one of the proposed EU candidate who should be elected by the European Parliament. So, several things here. Taking into account the European elections, that's new, shall be elected by the European Parliament, that's new, and qualified majority, that was already there from the Nice Treaty, but it's important to point that out. Two interpretations. You've got one interpretation, which is the interpretation of the leaderships in the European Parliament and most of the EU member states, which is that this was deliberately put in the treaties to connect the European elections to the choice of commissioners. That's what this was about. And the vehicle for doing that is rival candidates, which are present prior to the elections, which is not shown in law, and there are others who are calling for whatever this is in the treaties. So this is why we have Schulz and Juncker and Verhofstadt. The British government's interpretation is, no, it says that the governments go first, as they always have done. We should be sovereign, free to decide and nominate whoever we want to be the Commission President, and this is a complete sideshow. The European Parliament is trying to take this power away from governments, and that's outrageous. The British government, when I talk to the people in the Brussels, and I say, who else shares this view? I give you along with Sweden, Denmark, Czech Republic, Hungary. go talk to them all and we say, oh no, we don't. We agree with the German interpretation of this, which is that no, you have to be elections. And the more the German press are covering this, the more difficult it's going to be for Merkel to pick something else. So this is why, and here are some arguments about why it will either be Scholz or Juncker. The parliament will probably force the hand of the government. There's a European Council summit meeting before the first plenary session. It might not be clear at that European Council summit meeting who's the largest group in the parliament. And so there could be quite a lot of pressure to say, let's wait and see who is the largest group in this new parliament. It's going to be neck and neck between the two groups. It's going to be very difficult now for Juncker or Scholz to step aside and allow someone else to come through. So if the EPP are the largest group, Merkel's going to have to ask Juncker to step aside. He's going around Europe saying it's got to be either me or Scholz. He says it in the live TV debates, he says it in all the press. It's got this little bus that's going around different capitals in Europe. Scholz is never going to step aside if the socialists are the largest group. Key governments, particularly Germany, will be reluctant to go against what their press are perceiving as a democratic process. It might not be perfect, these might not be great candidates, but you've got to think like a German constitutional lawyer. If you sit in the German constitutional court, one of the criticisms is the EU is undemocratic because the Commission is undemocratic. And therefore, if the Commission is formed out of some electoral process, therefore the Commission is democratic. That's how the judges on the German constitutional court think about this. If that's the interpretation of German press, it's going to be very difficult for Merkel to go against that. There's likely to be a grand coalition with the two biggest groups in the middle of the parliament doing a deal. Whoever's the biggest one gets the Commission president, and we do a deal for the other one to get some other job, maybe the council president or high representative for foreign affairs. The other thing I'm hearing in various places when I go and talk about this stuff from I was in Stockholm a couple of weeks ago, Swedish government is now saying things like, well, the Commission president's not as powerful as it used to be, there's lots of other jobs in Brussels. And this idea is a kind of an excuse for why they might allow it to be Scholz or Juncker, so they can then say, who else are we going to put as the other big beast in the Commission, who's going to be council? So it's a kind of way of allowing it to be one of these two. On the no side, British government, some of the others are saying, well, we're going to be bullied by the European Parliament. Scholz and Juncker are appalling candidates. People are arguing unacceptable to several governments. Sweden was saying that. Governments say they prefer other people. The one to watch is Katainen, who is the Finnish Prime Minister who's quit, has announced he's quitting from Finland and wants a job in Brussels. And when asked, you want to be Commission President? He said, oh no, no, I don't want to be Commission President, but I want some kind of job in Brussels. So is he going to be an EPP candidate if the EPP are the largest group? But still, that would mean Juncker's got to step aside. The Economist and the British press love Christine Lagarde, but I just cannot see François Hollande nominating a political rival for the opposition party to be Commission President, and John can comment on this. Hello, Torning Schmidt, the British press love to talk about. In fact, Denmark is saying, yes, please have her, take her away. But she's only in her first term, she wants to win a second term. Juncker, few people have said, although this is dying, he doesn't want to be Commission President, he wants to be President of the European Council. He's denying that vociferously. Maybe he really is just going to, after the election, say, oh, well, I set aside for the rule of Europe, but I can't see that. But there's growing recognition that the government's messed up, and some of the big governments messed up. And whatever happens this time around, in 5 years' time, they're going to have to take this process far more seriously. They'll probably leave it till later, closer to the elections, and they'll probably press gain some sitting and prime ministers to lead themselves forward as the candidates of the choice before the elections, because this is probably going to be the way it's going to go. Finally, some potential policy implications. This very large anti-federalist populist coalition in the European Parliament, I say 200 plus because that includes the radical left as well as this big bloc on the radical right. A lot of the mainstream parties and politicians, Liberals, EPP, the free market wing of the Social Democrats, are saying that to generate growth in the European economy, the Commission has to have an agenda for liberalising services in the supermarket. This is one of the things the British government wants. I don't see this getting through this part very easily. The radical left are opposed to the liberalisation of the services sector, as they've always been. Radical right are opposed because it means renewal. deep economic and monetary union is going to be very difficult to get through. In the last parliament, there was a series of very tight votes where the socialists were split. There was a kind of centre-right coalition in favour of the called the Six Pack, the architecture for austerity, economic and monetary union, control of public finances, a narrow vote, banking union. If they have to pass anything else to do with economic and monetary, it's going to be really difficult. The radical right were opposed because they oppose bailouts. The radical left were opposed because they oppose austerity. TTIP, the EU-US free trade agreement, this is not going to be plain sailing. The left are opposed, half of the socialists are opposed, the Greens are opposed. Radical right are sort of populist European nationalists, particularly Le Pen. Farage, but Le Pen is, and some of the others around Europe are. Why should we bow down to the Americans who disband our food? European farmers, Japan, or whatever it is, for something like that. The key one thing to watch for me, and potentially the single most significant policy implication from these elections, could be free movement of people. When Cameron, 6-9 months ago, was saying he wanted to roll back a bit on free movement of people, for example, limit access to benefits, there was an outcry across Europe. Now, all the parties in Denmark are in favour, most of the parties in Holland are in favour, and the CDU are now making noises that they will also be in favour. Why? Because of the rise of the populist radical right. Mainstream parties on the centre right are losing voters. Conservatives losing voters to UKIP, the UNP losing voters to Le Pen, the Liberals and Christian Democrats losing voters to Wilders in Holland, the CDU worried about the rise of the AfD in Germany, and the Danish People's Party coming top of the polls in Denmark is really traumatic. So all of, in those states, the issue of free movement of people is the sort of real motivating factor for these groups on the right. And the mainstream parties on the centre-right are reacting to that. And so now I think one of the key issues is going to be, is this new European Parliament going to be pushing the Commission to start to think about ways to restrict the free movement of people? Governments might try and restrict that. You could see the European Parliament, a big block in the European Parliament, pushing for that. So I think that's something to watch.
Thank you. Simon Green from Aston.
Thank you very much. My comments will hopefully dovetail quite nicely with what Simon was talking about on the pan-European perspective. Because I'm going to be talking about Germany, and Germany is, as the largest EU member state, is particularly important, of course, in Europe more generally. While we have to distinguish, of course, between the European elections themselves, which in Germany, like in most other European countries, are actually particularly important. Or even despite television debates and the like, actually all that much interest in the Germany in European elections. That's historically the case. It matters because Germany is just the most important state in the European Union. What's particularly interesting in that sense is the way that Germany has become ever more important over the past 10, 15 years. Whereas in the past, Germany had a kind of self-imposed limits on its power, it was reflexively, instinctively sought multilateral solutions to all kinds of foreign policy issues. It always acted in tandem with the French government and the Franco-German relationship being the motive of European integration. In recent years, especially since the financial crisis, this has changed somewhat because Germany has had a mantle of not necessarily assertiveness, but a kind of responsibility almost thrust upon it. I don't think it's fair to say that Germany has sought this role. No German government has really ever wanted to be in a position where it's wanted to impose its will on its neighbours or partners. But it had no choice, partly because of the nature of the beast of the global financial crisis, which has meant that the German government had to underwrite rather large loans for lots of countries, but also because public opinion has been rather sceptical of these loans and hasn't been particularly in favour of them. So Germany has had to attach relatively stringent conditions to these loans, such as the austerity packages, which are in place in many of those countries where the bailout funds are still active. But the point is that Germany now really is the most important. It used to be Germany and France together being the most important member states of the European Union. Now it really is Germany, and that's partially because of the way that Germany has evolved, also partially, John will talk about this of course too, is that France has kind of fallen back a little bit, partially because of its own economic problems and because of its political weakness. So Germany matters more than ever before in today's European Union, and that of course therefore also translates into the UK calculations. It's no longer the largest, it's still the largest single country in terms of MEPs, but the crucial point is that the German MEPs will make the largest, be the largest contingent, both the EPP and the European Socialists. So in terms of what happens both in the election of the Commission President, but also then of course for the policy debates which come after, given that most initiatives in the European Parliament tend to be decided as some form of formal or informal grand coalition, the German MEPs are going to be particularly important. And of course we've seen that one of the candidates for Commission President is indeed a German. So let me just, I just kind of want to talk through some of these points which I've raised in my paper here, but just to talk about perhaps two particular points about, firstly, what do European elections mean for Germany, and in particular for German politics, which of course is going to be important looking forward, both in terms of Britain's position, but also in terms of the political, the policy agenda in Europe, as Simon has already outlined. So, first of all, need to note on just for the record in terms of the likely result, I've put down on my paper here the recent polls and compared them to the 2013 federal election results and the 2009 election result. The key thing about European elections in Germany, and this bucks a bit with the point that Simon raises about opposition parties, in Germany, Christian Democrats win European elections. The Christian Democrats won every single European election that has ever taken place. It's only won in 1989 when they actually run ever so slightly close by the Social Democrats, but not all the Christian Democrats were clear winners. And in truth, that was going to happen in Germany this time. You see that the Social Democrats have improved very slightly, but the fact that the Christian Democrats are somewhere between 35% and 40%, short of their really quite spectacular result of 41.5% in the 2013 federal election, is itself remarkable. What one does see is that there are clearly some losers. The big loser here is the FDP, which I'll come back to. One of the big winners on this is the AfD, and so I'm going to allude to that too. And I'll also say we'll come back to that a bit first. Let me just say something about what this means for the party, but also perhaps for Simon mentioned the Federal Constitutional Court. One of my favourite games is to try to think like a federal constitutional lawyer, and it is a nerdy game, as I'm happy to concede that, but there are some quite interesting elements. As you probably know, in German national elections, there is a threshold for representation. If you want to get into the Bundestag, your party has to score 5% of the vote nationally in order to qualify for seats. That used to hold true for European elections. However, after the last European election, the Federal Constitutional Court said, no, you can't have that anymore. So the government said, well, okay, let's have a threshold of 3%. Then lots of parties took the government again, or the parliament again to court, and the Constitutional Court again ruled on this, actually, only months ago, and basically said, no, you can't have that either. There must be no threshold. And the reason why there must be no threshold is itself interesting. The reason why there is no threshold is because, according to the Federal Constitutional Court, European elections don't matter because they don't actually elect the government. So you might well say, well, kind of self-fulfilling prophecy on that, but that is in fact the logic of the Federal Constitutional Court in its infinite limitless wisdom. So what this means is that at this election, any party which will score a shade over 1% of the vote will actually get an MEP. So you no longer need that 5%. Now that in turn matters, it matters obviously for the outcome, but it also matters for the way that, for the implications of the election for German domestic politics and for the future of the parties going forward. And there's two things in particular I want to pick up on. And the first is the Liberal FDP. Now the FDP, whilst is the most successful party in German politics in terms of governmental participation. It's been longer in the government than any other party. However, in the 2013 federal election, as you will core, rather spectacularly crashed and burned and fell below the 5% hurdle. Now, since then, this is a seismic change in German politics. The FDP, the Liberal FDP, was always the kingmaker in German politics. It was the party with whom the two big parties would normally have to form a coalition in order to govern. It is now out of the equation. The question, of course, is can it come back? Well, you would have thought that with a European election, when there's no 5% threshold, this is going to be a pretty golden opportunity for the party to come back. Well, it's currently polling about 3%. So the fact that it is below the 5% threshold, even on an election where the 5% threshold does not matter, probably does not bode well for its chances for the future. That, in turn, is absolutely critical for what happens after the next federal election, which is in 2017. Nobody ever in Germany, not least the two participating partners, assumes that the grand coalition we currently have CDU, CSU, and the SPD is anything other than a temporary solution. There will be a strong pressure to go back to a kind of minimal winning coalition type of offer, which we would normally have. But the question is then, who will the CDU have as a coalition partner? Because they no longer have a natural partner, which is the Liberals. Well, that's an open question. And the obvious partner for this, the obvious solution for this, would be the Greens. That's, of course, not an entirely uncomplicated scenario. But nonetheless, you can see that if you had a Christian Democrat Green coalition in Germany's in Europe's largest state, that might have some quite interesting implications for politics and policy more broadly. Now, the second part I want to just pick up on is the Alternative für Deutschland, the Eurosceptic AfD. Now, this is a particularly interesting creation for a number of reasons. The first reason is this, and again this is a bit different to, Germany is different here to other European countries. The most parties like the Front National and the UKIP and other rightly populist parties capture the votes of the losers of globalization. In Germany, the losers of globalization vote together with the losers of unification and they actually vote left. So we have in Germany a left-wing populist party, the Left Party, which will actually do quite well at the European election, as it has done at the federal election. In fact, it's the largest non-government party in parliament. So you have this split. And normally in Germany, the losers of unification and the losers of globalization vote on the left. However, with the AfD, we now have for the first time a potential party emerging on the right, really since the 1960s, the late 1960s, when the extreme right wing, much more extreme right wing, NPD almost got election to parliament. That's a long time ago.
Don't they really probably want to see them?
Yeah, they probably will, because you only get 1%, so it's quite likely that they will get something that's 9%, about 6% for other parties. So the AfD. Is an absolute new creation. It's only been formed about 2 years ago, and is campaigns for Germany basically to exit the Euro. It's a campaign for an exit from the European Union, but it means that it campaigns for an exit the Euro. So it looks like it's set to score about 6% at the European elections, so we'll comfortably also reach to take that 5% hurdle, which it narrowly missed in 2013. So the interesting thing is you see how the CDU-CSU will react to this. In fact, you would have thought that after the federal election, there would be a kind of shock going through, not unlike what happens with Conservatives in Britain and then they're faced with UKIP. In fact, the CDU-CSU is very much holding its course. It's not trying to emulate the AfD. It's basically staying in line, holding line, and not allowing itself so far to be blown, of course, by them. The question, of course, with all of these parties, and in particular someone like AfD, which is completely new, it's completely untested, it's completely untried, is how actually they fare once they actually gain representation. History suggests that such parties have a tendency to implode in one juncture, one way or another, either through their members saying silly things or investing funds or both. So we have some interesting dynamics there. There is a very interesting similarity here between the AfD and the UKIP, and that's a common question of immigration. Interestingly enough, German voters are actually, in general, relaxed about immigration. They actually see that generation, that immigration is a benefit to German society. That reflects the fact that the economy is generally booming, it's doing very well, so there's an economic need for migration, but also the fact that Germany's demographics are absolutely parlous and about to head south in a very big way from about 2020 onwards, when the size of the population, the structure of the population, changes quite fundamentally. So the population as a whole is much more relaxed about immigration than in other European countries. The one exception to that is AfD voters. So you can see there too, there's an alignment to work with AfD with other European countries. So that's just somehow how this will kind of impact on German politics. Let me say a little bit about what this, all of this, or the German results mean for the UK, because of course the UK British government is particularly keen to see what happens in Germany in light of its attempts to renegotiate the terms of membership of the EU for 2017. So the government, I think, will welcome a victory for the CDU-CSU, not least because they've figured out that the SPD kind of gaining an influence will mean that there will be less understanding from the German side for the British position. However, I have to say that I am struck by the degree to which British commentators and politicians almost willfully overestimate the extent to which Germany is actually going to go and actually make things happen on behalf of Britain. There seems to be a latent assumption somehow that other countries will agree to our terms of renegotiation because Germany will tell them to do so, and Germany will tell them to do so because they really want us to stay in. Now, I don't think there's any doubt the German government really wants Britain to stay in, but the German government also has absolutely no appetite or no interest in doing basically the United Kingdom's dirty work for it. If there is to be a successful renegotiation of the terms of membership, and I think it's fair to say that it's not just a big if, it's an absolutely enormous if, not least because of the timescales involved, it'll be with the tacit support.